Confusion over the president's immigration policies and what happens to these kids now, separated from their parents at the border. And now, just moments ago, the president calls the heartbreaking stories fake. Just moments ago, he wrote this, quote, "We must maintain a strong southern border. We cannot allow our country to be overrun by illegal immigrants as the Democrats tell their phony stories of sadness and grief, hoping it will help them in the elections. Obama and others had the same pictures and did nothing about it. Phony stories? Tell that to the hundreds and hundreds, thousands of children separated from their parents. 500 of them have been reunited, but what does that mean for the other 1,800? And tell that to this mother who had to sue the Trump administration after her son was taken from her nearly a month ago when they crossed the border as undocumented immigrants. She says they were planning to seek asylum. Listen to this. That is very real. Abby Phillip is at the White House with more this morning. Good morning, Abby.
Well, good morning, Poppy. That's exactly right. Despite what the president and now it seems the White House is saying, characterizing some of these stories as fake, we know, according to the Trump administration, that there are, in fact, 2,300 children who were separated from their families over the last 6 weeks. That's a very high number that increased dramatically because of the zero tolerance policy. And the president calling them phony. Now, Sarah Huckabee Sanders, the White House press secretary, just tweeted moments ago that it's shameful the Democrats are using a photo of a young girl that was on Time magazine to exploit her to advance their agenda. The White House seeming to try to change the subject from what has been a lot of questions in the last 48 hours about how exactly they are going to implement the president's own executive order that calls for the separation practice to end. How are these parents and these children going to be reunited? Does the administration even know where the parents and the children are? The administration is saying, basically, we're working on it, asking for time as they implement this policy. But there's also additional questions being raised now about what happens in the future. What happens when the families are kept together? Where are they going to be detained and for how long? The Trump administration essentially asking the Department of Justice Department of Defense to open up beds for these immigrants and the Department of Justice simultaneously asking the courts for permission to hold children for longer than 20 days, which was previously the longest amount of time that they could hold onto them. All of this is happening while Republicans on the Hill are frantically searching for the votes to get an immigration proposal passed, an immigration proposal that would deal with a number of immigration-related issues, but also the family separation policy. The president threw a wrench in that this morning, saying, don't even bother. Let's just wait until November when he says they'll have more Republican votes, Poppy.
Abby Phillip at the White House, thank you for that. Also this morning, no clear answer to what happens to many of these children already being held in these shelters. Despite the president's executive order that stops further separations, it doesn't affect what happens to the kids now. Nick Valencia is outside of one of those in the border city of Brownsville, Texas. And Nick, you've just learned some new information regarding some of the reunification of these families. Is that right?
Yeah, good morning, Poppy. Some breaking news here on CNN. A statement sent to us by the U.S. Customs and Border Protection, Pete Ladowich, a spokesman. And I want to read this statement here to our viewers. The administration continues to work to reunify prosecuted parents with their children. U.S. Customs and Border Protection has unified approximately 500 children, over 15%, they say, with their parents who had been referred for prosecution for illegal entry. U.S. Immigration and Customs Enforcement, along with Health and Human Services, are developing a process to be centered at ICE's Port Isabel Detention Center to continue unification efforts. We have to take their word here at this statement. There's no way for us to independently verify all these 500 children, they say, that are back with their parents. The problem with all of this, Poppy, is that this is an administration that has been very limited with forthcoming information. As a matter of fact, this facility that I'm standing in front of, which is funded by the federal government, Health and Human Services, has 40 children in all that were separated as a result of this zero-tolerance policy, and among them is an 8-month-old infant, a child that we're not even sure the officials inside know where their parents are. Poppy?
Nick Valencia reporting. Thank you very, very much. I appreciate it. And joining me now is the Republican mayor of El Paso, Texas, Dee Margo. Of course, El Paso is the largest U.S. city on the Mexico border. Thank you for being here, Mr. Mayor.
I'm happy to be here, Poppy.
Let's talk about, in a moment, what you saw when you toured these facilities. But I have to get your reaction as a Republican mayor to what the president just said. He just tweeted, "We cannot allow our country to be overrun by illegal immigrants as the Democrats tell their phony stories of sadness and grief." Are these phony stories of sadness and grief, Mayor? You're on the front lines of this.
Well, first of all, El Paso is the safest city in the United States. We're, as you said, the largest city on the U.S.-Mexico mm-hmm. border. We're the 19th largest city in the United States, and I like to say we're the nexus of three states, New Mexico, Chihuahua, Texas, mm-hmm. two countries in one region comprising 2.7 million people. When I had the conference of mayors here yesterday and then the night before, we stood at a building looking out on south and west, and I said, "Can you tell me the difference between where El Paso ends and Juarez, Mexico begins?" And none of them could. So we are here, and we are where the border issues are most prevalent.
But
we have no issues on the criminal side.
Well, and we'll get to that in a moment because the president says otherwise. But the fact that the president is saying this morning, stating as fact from the White House, that these stories that we and every media outlet has been reporting, he says they are phony stories of sadness and grief, basically engineered by Democrats to get elected again. Do you agree with that?
It's not what we're about as a nation. The children should not have been separated from their parents. We were not allowed to go into the Tornillo shelter yesterday. They require a 2-week notice. I did do some digging yesterday after the mayors left, and I found out that there are only boys there, 13 to 17 years of age, and were considered unaccompanied minors who are being processed for asylum or to be placed with other relatives. But so they're not the young children separated that we've talked about. But in any event, none of this should have been happening. But the root cause, this is symptomatic of a root cause, and the root cause is the fact that over the last 30 years, there hasn't been enough intestinal fortitude in Washington to deal with immigration reform to begin with, on both sides of the aisle. This is neither a Republican or Democrat, it's both.
You know, you have learned what you can about these facilities in your district, in your city, without being permitted into them, which a lot of people take issue with, that you couldn't see the facilities without a 2-week notice. The Washington Post is reporting they spoke to Legal Aid, a legal aid group helping the families, the Texas Civil Rights Project. They're representing about 300 parents who've been separated from their kids. And they said that they've only been able to track down from those 300 parents two of the children so far. Are you going to be able to help in this in any way? And do you have a sense that there even is any federal system, federal tracking database to reconnect these more than 2,300 children with their parents?
Well, what I did discover yesterday, or what I was informed in the little bit of due diligence I did, was that, first of all, in some cases, if the parents have been jailed, it's going to be kind of hard to reunite the children with their parents, so they need to deal with that. But on the other hand, they're saying that they're being processed appropriately, that they do look for relatives or other family members where they can place them. But I don't know how well the system works. I'm not sure. I mean, we really shouldn't be here to begin with.
You know, I just want you to listen to what the president said earlier this week. Two things he said about these immigrants that certainly struck us. Listen.
Mexico is doing nothing for us except taking our money and sending us drugs.
They're not sending their finest, that I can tell you. And we're sending them the hell back.
As the mayor of the largest border town, is that what you're seeing from Mexico, a country that only sends, in the president's words, drugs and takes our money?
No, that heated rhetoric is not applicable to El Paso or what I observe here. We have We're a community of over, that's been, has been, we're one binational, bilingual, bicultural community for over 400 years. Mm-hmm. We have families on both sides. Commerce takes place on both sides. For every four jobs in the maquila manufacturing facilities in Juarez, Mexico, there's one job here in El Paso. We have 50,000 employed because of our relationship with Mexico. So I have a hard time with some of that rhetoric. We're over 80% Hispanic. Mm-hmm. My great-great-grandmother came from Mexico. My great-grandmother came from Mexico. And my grandfather didn't speak English till he was 18. We are a true regional bicultural community. This is where people, if they want to talk from Washington about the border and about Mexico, they need to come down here. But one other thing I'd like to throw in. The rhetoric on the wall is ridiculous. It's not helpful. When I hear the wall, the talk about the wall, I think of the Berlin Wall. We have a fence through most of El Paso that was done during the Bush administration. Works fine. It was designed to keep a criminal element out. It wasn't so much for the migration as it was the criminal element. We had, you know, car thefts and things like that. But it's a see-through. You can see through. It works. It's fine. But most of Texas, from a border standpoint, is private land. So they're not going to be able to do what they think they're going to do. There are places that there ought to be. We do need to protect our borders. We are a sovereign nation, and Mexico needs to do more to build up their middle class and their economy so that their residents aren't trying to come here.
So to be clear, you're Republican mayor of the largest border city in this country, and you say that a $25 billion wall is not the answer.
No, it won't work. It won't work completely, but there are places that they ought to build fence to control our border. But no, a wall isn't going to work, nor is the rhetoric associated with it helpful.
Yeah. Mayor DeMargo, I appreciate you being there. Please let us know when you are allowed to enter these facilities and come back and tell us what you see, okay?
Will do.
Thank you, sir.